Well, hello, MIT Applied Energy Symposium. It's an honor to be here. I'm Andy Zelay, class of 69, course 16. The reason I'm here is because at our 50th reunion, I met my classmates, John Brown and Ray Smith, and heard President Reif talk about MIT being committed to renewable energy and carbon free. So I'd like to share with you some slides on how we can get to that that commitment. So problem solving in today's technology, sea-based wind. The problem solving starts with the knowledge transfer from the oil and gas industry over to the wind turbine industry. This is a conventional oil gas platform, and it's a floater. And here you see a floating wind turbine. This is the Tri-Wind floater from the US. And the reason that we can talk about this is because the capital spending on sea-based wind is predicted to eclipse the offshore oil in Europe within 2 years. Here you see a photograph of an oil and gas platform being towed to shore for decommissioning. In the back, you see other oil gas platforms. And then in between, you see these wind turbines. These happen to be on fixed bottom foundations. So you see that there's a change in the industry, this transfer. The other point is that in the US, the offshore wind resource is like the goal is 86 gigawatts by 2050. This is the DOE NREL goal. And if you look at this, you can see that most of that, the largest portion of that 86 megawatts, 28 megawatts, is in the North Atlantic, which is where we're located. And if you look further, you see that the best wind resource is right off our doorsteps. You see this very dark area. And so we're sitting on top of a beautiful wind resource. We have the technology, the knowledge transfer. So how do we get there? Well, first we have to look at what the importance is, what the milestones could be. When you look at sea-based wind, that's about twice the US load. And the US load is 455 gigawatts, or about 4,000 terawatt hours. So the potential for sea-based wind is actually twice that. So we could do 900 gigawatts of power offshore. And it turns out that the potential offshore is greater than onshore. And as we said before, we have a world-class wind resource near our population centers. Here's the 10 meter per second contours. Here's Boston over here. I'm sorry, Boston right here. Here you have Cape Ann, and then you have the Gulf of Maine. And so where's the floating offshore being considered? Well, it's in this area here when you're above 60 meters depth. And if you look at the US, you can see that the North Atlantic is one of the best poised to get offshore wind floaters. We have some in the Pacific, but and some on the Great Lakes, but mostly in the North Atlantic. So what is the offshore wind opportunity? Well, in the US, we have one operating offshore project. It's called Block Island. It's owned and operated by Ørsted, which used to be called Adong. And it's located right here. Not a very high wind area, but it's the first one. Then, we have in Europe, we have 107 offshore wind projects operating, 5 gigawatts, equivalent to about 5 nuclear plants, mostly in the North Atlantic off Germany and off England. And then when you look at Block Island, this is Block Island right here. So in Block Island, what we're using is Gulf Coast Oil Technology, which is the steel jacket foundations. They were built in two halves so that they could ship them over here. And then we have a European ocean-going vessel, a heavy crane to install the turbine. These are the GE 6-megawatt turbines. And then you see one installed already. So in conclusion, the US is just getting its feet wet. We have one 30-megawatt project. They have 5 gigawatts of projects. And we're using their technology, basically. We're using this heavy vessel came from Europe because we don't have any Jones-compliant vessels in the US. And then these are the leases, and I'll talk to you about the leases a little bit later. So what are the advantages of floating deep water technology? You're more familiar with this than I am because MIT has a Naval Architecture Department, and they actually patented the TLP, the tension leg platform. In the tension leg platform, which looks like an underwater buoy, you have these tendons that support the buoy. The buoy is filled with air, so it's light, and it pulls against the tendons. The other design, the other major class of design is the high water plane floater, which is like a conventional ship where the buoyancy is given, the water plane gives you the necessary buoyancy. When you tip it to one side, you have more water plane on one side than the other, so it tends to right itself. And then you have the spar buoy. The spar buoy is like the tension leg platform. The distinction is that here you have these tendons in tension. Here, all of the restoring force is gravity, and you have a passive anchor. And that's a big difference because here you have very large uplifting forces. Here you have minor lifting forces. Also, the impact on the bottom of the ocean is different. So which of these technologies is going to have the best engineering solution? Well, that's up to the future. But you're familiar with the low water plane ships, which are very stable. They don't rock very much, as opposed to the high water plane ships like this fishing boat, which tends to rock back and forth. And that's a very big consideration. The wind turbines are usually placed in the highest wind resource area with the highest wave, highest significant wave heights. So you can imagine the forcing function on these large turbines, and then you get to pick what kind of foundation you want. Do you want the stable foundation, or are you willing to do a light foundation? The experience we've had personally is in Hawaii. In Hawaii, we looked at the tension leg platform for a project, and we tested it at the largest wave tank in the world at Marin. For Hawaii, we found that you need about a 50-foot max wave height, so the TLP needs to survive the 50-foot max wave height. The only way we could do that was to put in some type of water ballasting, because if one of these legs goes slack, one of the tendons goes slack, then you could lose the whole system. You could then break the other tendons, and it would topple over. And because of that, we went to the, our current design is the spar buoy, and I'll show you a little bit more about that. So what are the current engineering limitations? Well, the number one is you need a system that works, which means all the pieces have to work. So the aerodynamics has to work, the structures has to work, the ocean engineering has to work, and then the electrical system has to work, the control system. And all of these have to work flawlessly. Then the other challenge is a Jones Act compliant vessel. You need a vessel that can put the system in operation. And then, of course, the US supply chain and port facilities. So we'll go through these. This is the high wind project in Scotland. In Scotland, they put these spar buoy floaters up, and they used the largest marine crane available to do that. They did the mating in the fjord in Norway. So what they did was they first floated the spar buoy. It's a steel spar buoy. And then when the spar buoy was floated, then they got the crane and they put the turbine on top of the spar buoy. And then they floated the whole system from Norway to Scotland. It's about 2,000 miles. And that's how they put it in service. This is the French solution. The French have this donut solution, which is a floater. So this is the high water plane floater. And what they're doing is they're building a new port to be able to manufacture these. And you can see these very large cranes. They have four of them, which you need in order to put together the floater and also to erect the turbine on top. And they don't have any bridges, so they can do this. They can float the whole turbine with the floater out to the deep water site, which is a challenge in the US. Okay, so what is the new technology? Well, this is one concept. It's a next generation offshore wind turbine generator deployed on a novel ceramic composite spar buoy by a US installation vessel, by a Jones Act compliant vessel. So you start off with a port where you can do the construction. This happens to be Hawaii Kalaula Harbor, where we tendered a project. Here's the concrete plant right near there. So we could ship the concrete over here and build the structure and then float it out to the deep water site. And then once you get done, it looks kind of like this. So you have a transition piece coming up out of the water. You have the large turbine and it looks very clean. So the manufacturing process, the very first step is to do the spar buoy. In our case, we want to do it out of ceramic composite concrete as opposed to Portland cement. And we can do this in a port or graving dock. And then we can float it out, since it's got air chambers in it, we can float it out to the site. Once we get out to the site, we can water ballast the spar buoy in the vertical position and float it underneath the installation vessel. This installation vessel can carry two turbines and it's self-erecting. It's got a gantry crane to move the turbine components. It's got a pedestal crane to do the erection. And the most important part is it's got strand jacks built into these retaining rings so that they can lift the turbine and the spar buoy without having to get that massive offshore crane. You can also do this at the site in a very short time because you have people on board 24/7. So the time sequence to get the spar buoy floated under there and erect the turbine is on the order of 2 days. New material technology. This is one of the strengths that MIT and Harvard have. We have a nano lab, and this can be applied to offshore wind. This is the Troll A platform, which is actually the largest movable structure in the world. This was built for the Ørsted oil gas platforms in the North Sea. And it's made out of marine concrete. This is a bottom-founded foundation. So they floated this out and then they set the oil gas platform on top. I'm told this is about half steel. So half of this structure is steel rebar. The one advantage we could have would be to use basalt rebar instead of steel rebar so that you don't have any corrosion and you have basically an unlimited service life. We're saying 100 years, but that needs to be tested. The other portion is, instead of using Portland cement, we use geopolymer cement with basalt fibers. So this is a different chemical composition, which allows you to do the pouring faster. And also it's a stronger cement than Portland. Here, Oklahoma State University did tests on the geopolymer cement versus the Portland cement. You can see the geopolymer cement is stronger. And I'm not showing it here, but it's also lighter and it's got less coefficient of thermal expansion. So it's an easier material to work with and it has higher tensile strength. So what we can do then is you do the spar construction on shore using complex formwork. This is the formwork that is used for projects like roads and bridges. You need a horizontal custom steel formwork. You can't do this vertically because you don't have enough room in the port to float it out vertically. And you don't want to have a big crane to lift this like they did. And then you can do a horizontal tow from port to the deep water site. And then once you get to the site, you can do a vertical ballasting and installation with the installation vessel. And then the result is you have at sea a turnkey project in the matter of a few days using one installation vessel, as opposed to having a very large crane, a very large marine crane. Well, the guts of it are a little more complicated. So this is what the cross-section looks like. These numbers are not correct because really this needs to be about 50-foot diameter. This is about 80-foot diameter. But if you're interested, I can send you the drawings. But this is the cross-section that you need so that you can mate it to the anchoring ring over here at the corner, at the aft end. And then you can telescope the turbine sections inside the spar buoy. And then you can lift them up by means of a strand jack. So this is what the strand jack looks like that's able to do it. And so this in effect replaces that very large marine crane. And you have all of the pieces there to assemble, including the barium mud, which you use for the bottom section. And you end up with an integrated offshore wind turbine generator. And you can free float it, the fully assembled unit. You can anchor it in place and place it into service. And you can reverse the process for decommissioning. So what would the problem solution look like? Well, let's say we start off with a 12 megawatt turbine. This is the largest GE turbine. And right now we do not have installation vessels able to handle this. And it's the European companies that are actually doing the work right now. They will use European vessels. And so the question is, where's our Yankee ingenuity and our seafaring history? Well, this is how the project could look like. Here's Cape Ann in Gloucester. We could put in these 14 12 megawatt turbines in the Gulf of Maine, about 20 to 30 miles offshore. In a couple of rows. And this would generate 168 megawatts, about 850 gigawatt hours of renewable power. And it turns out that the MIT Harvard campus could use 168 megawatts of, 850 gigawatt hours of renewable energy to meet their renewable energy goal. So where's the future of offshore wind technology? I think it rests with our institutions and our students. When you look at today's technology, those 12 megawatt wind turbines are equivalent in sail area to 16 of these colonial ships. And when you look at the spar buoy is equivalent to about six Liberty ships. So you have quite a bit of a challenge to develop the technology to do the offshore wind floaters. Here's the MIT campus and the Harvard campus. MIT has a 40 megawatt cogen plant right here. You could use that to back up the 168 megawatt offshore wind project and reduce the carbon emissions. And you could add Harvard to it as well. You could make it bigger than 168 megawatts if Harvard needs more energy or more power. And the bottom line is you could create jobs and benefits for our kids and our grandchildren. And you could take the center of excellence from Europe and move it over to Boston and make some progress, giving our Yankee ingenuity and our 400 years of seafaring history. If you have any questions, I'd be glad to answer them.